Welcome to Smart Mouth. We are the podcast that talks to our favorite people about their favorite foods. I am your host, Catherine Spires. Quick note, I just realized that I should be posting more of your food photos, my dear listeners. So we are on Instagram and Facebook at Smart Mouth Podcast if you want to send me some photos and I can repost them. And if you prefer to email them to us, smartmouthpod@gmail.com. I want to see what you guys are eating. Today, our guest is Rose Lawrence. Hi, Rose.
Hi.
She is the chef and owner of Red Bread, which makes delicious bread products here in Los Angeles, sends them out everywhere. You have a legion of fans, right?
Oh, well, I hope so.
I mean, you can just say yes. No one knows if you don't.
No, yes, but I always feel, I don't know, it's better to be humble.
Don't ever do that. You're a woman. You don't have time to be humble.
I think you may have given me a new life motto, so good. Thank you already.
Good. You wanted to talk about bread, but it's interesting when you talk to someone who works in a specific industry, we can't just say, okay, we'll talk about bread, because you were like, well, what kind of bread? And I was like, oh, right. Like, there's all these different types. So we talked about the different types. Mm-hmm. And we finally settled on baguettes. Like, mm-hmm. That's what we'll focus on. But it's not necessarily that baguettes are your one true love.
No, I couldn't possibly pick a one true love.
Right.
It depends.
On your mood?
On the day, okay. On the weather.
Okay. What are like some of the breads that you make that you especially like making?
So I always like really flavorful things. I try to always adhere to that old adage that like there's a flavor rule, and that is that flavor rules. So that is my driving force. So I'm always looking to use 100% whole grains, which is sort of our baseline at the bakery, but also incorporating some really rich flavors. So one of the breads we're really well known for, and it's actually a pain in the ass to make because it has the most ingredients of everything we have.
So of course, people want it all the time.
Uh-huh. And I want it all the time. Uh-huh. So we're still trucking 7 years later. Is this Russian black bread.
Okay.
And it's rich with chocolate and molasses and apple cider vinegar and caraway and fennel. And it's just really intense. So one slice feels like a meal.
I was going to say, that's a lot. Yeah. That does sound like a meal. That's a lot of really heavy ingredients.
Mm-hmm. And it's really great with just butter and dill or pastrami, another great love of mine.
Right.
So I just really like these like dark, dense, wonderfully flavored things. And I love baguettes because I definitely love crust more than crumb. I like that crackle, that crunch. I think that's pretty American. I've heard before that if we were culturally defined as a texture, we would be crunch in terms of like what we seek in food.
Interesting.
Whereas like a lot of Asian cuisines are more like slime and goo, right?
Okay, like sauces and stuff.
For the slime and goo?
Yeah.
I think more like natto and like mushrooms and slurries and stuff like that.
Ooh, I don't want to talk about natto. No, thank you. For anyone, I will though, to tell people what it is. Semi-fermented soybeans that mm-hmm. have this texture on them that's rather reminiscent of a certain bodily fluid.
Yeah. So it's slimy and gooey. Yes, but here
disgusting.
We like potato chips and mm-hmm. we like candy bars with snaps in them.
Yeah.
It's just like something we crave.
Okay. It's so funny because Americans are known for loving like action and adventure and like we even want it in our mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, like, a lot going
Crunch,
on all
pow.
The time. Yeah. Exactly. Oh, I love that. Okay. So your really complicated flavorful breads, you mentioned the crumb and that is essentially like the inside of the
inside,
bread.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which has its own merits. It's soft. It's billowy. It's really lovely.
Mm-hmm.
Just like that crackle.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So let's talk a little bit about what a baguette is. Now, we sort of know them by their shape. They're long and thin. And the word baguette sort of means wand or stick or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like its original Latin root. But apparently the word baguette wasn't used to describe that type of bread until the 1920s, which is an issue we'll get into a little bit later. But would you say that baguette and French bread are synonymous?
No. I think when people think about French bread, they're actually talking about more like a submarine-shaped roll.
Okay.
Like it's meant for sandwiches, at mm-hmm. least in the lexicon I am familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas a baguette is really referring to something that is far longer than it is wide, mm-hmm. And has all these, as you mentioned, sort of these like legendary qualities and attributes it needs to check off in order to be considered a baguette.
Right.
So I feel like, obviously, a baguette is a style of French bread, but it is not the shape. And French bread kind of means to people like a crusty white bread at this point.
Yeah, I agree with, I think I agree with that. I realized I hadn't thought about that.
Well, I find like the history of bread in France is so interesting because it's so tied to class and revolution.
Yes.
Right? Because white flour was all for the royalty and the privileged, and the peasants were eating these dark, rich loaves, which, mm-hmm. you know, again, I think are far more interesting.
Yeah.
But it was this idea that they were fighting for like the right to white bread.
Yeah.
And then after the revolution, there was like no white bread for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then suddenly, like, prosperity came around when it was like the every man can afford a white loaf of bread.
Yes.
And it's a status symbol now. And it's sort of the same way here. We kind of look down on these browner breads when they are far more nutritionally rich and more flavorful.
Do you think that we look down on brown breads? I feel like that is a matter of perception because I'm someone who pays a lot of attention to, like, where I feel like theories of nutrition and what's considered nutritious changes like every 6 months. So I'm always really interested in reading articles about like, well, this is what you should be eating. And I do think there was one guy who once said, he wrote a whole book about how to lose weight. And his whole theory was that like you should eat light food. So he said you should eat baguettes because they're so airy inside. So stupid. I cannot believe who gets book deals. But I think that it's generally agreed upon by everybody, even people who are like, don't eat carbs. They say, if you must, eat a, the more complex the carb.
Right.
And I mean, it's tricky because sometimes supermarket breads, for instance, as you know, are dark through artificial coloring.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
So it's really hard to like suss out what's healthier for you, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, I think that food is such an interesting topic because it's the only thing we all need,
mm-hmm.
and it's sort of a strange commodity if mm-hmm. if we define something we all need. So I come from a legal background, and so for me, things that everyone needs are human rights.
Okay.
So it's odd to have a human right that is also commodified. And I don't think that they have to be separate, but I think that you have to be intentional as a result and transparent. And as you said, a lot of these breads are darker because of additives, and a lot of people are being told multiple things, and a lot of marketing is based on fear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so it becomes very hard intentionally for customers, consumers to figure out what's the truth, who's telling the truth. And in America, we love the silver bullet. We love the simple answer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even if you have a conversation, as I did today for 5 hours about how complicated bread was, there was always a student, and it changed, who would raise their hand and be like, yeah, but if you could just say it in a sentence.
Oh,
like,
really?
But I can't. And isn't that wonderful? So I think, like, there's a lot behind it. Like, we need to get people more excited about complex problems because our food system is very complex, and it's interesting, and you have a lot of power in it if you engage in it. I think in general, like when I have people come, it's not that like they think, you know, in old terms of like, oh, well, brown bread is for the peasant.
Uh-huh.
That is not me. I am middle class, you know? It's more that they think like, well, it's not going to be as fluffy and it's not as nice. And it's kind of this, not only like flavor wise, kind of a baby palate because it lacks exposure, right? Your starches have mostly been like totally flat.
Yes.
And haven't challenged you at all.
Right.
And the flavors of wheat are earthy
mm-hmm.
and bitter.
Mm-hmm.
And these are really good for us,
yeah.
right? But we don't eat a lot of that in America. We like salty and
yeah.
sweet.
Yeah.
So it's a challenging taste for us, but it is the foundation of every culture. And I agree with you. Nutrition, crazy. Back and forth, all over the place. A lot of it on fear. But I think at the end of the day, your individual experience is incredibly powerful. And if you put it in your mouth, and even if you don't like it at first because it's about training the palate, if it tastes complex and odd or tastes at all, that is not only a wonderful perk of eating, but your body's way of interpreting nutrition.
Huh.
Right? Like your nose and your mouth are meant to be your detectives in the world
right.
for nutrition. And your eyes too, right? Colors give us information about what we can eat. Smells give us information about what we can eat. And we've kind of forgotten like this powerful biological instinct we have that is actually getting nutrition data through our senses.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, clearly you're a teacher. Because that's what you're talking about, people coming to you and people asking questions. You teach baking classes as well. And I was wondering if part of that is, do you ever blow people's mind by telling them there's actually different kinds of wheats that have totally different flavor profiles?
Oh, yeah. And my mind was only like blown about that a couple years ago because I was still using whole grains, but there was only a few because, again, this movement builds and like it becomes an aggregate. The more people involved, the more wonderful things there are. And finally getting to taste enough of a variety. And then even within a grain, the seasonality from year to year and from farmer to farmer in practice and really start tasting that has been crazy for me and for other people. And sometimes it can be overwhelming.
How so?
Just a lot of information.
Oh, right? Sure. That makes sense.
I mean, and like, I'm throwing out a lot of information to you right now.
But the other thing that's, you know, unfortunate is that it's heritage grain is making a bit of a comeback, which is cool, but it's still small enough that it's not accessible. Heritage grains are still expensive. That's not anyone's fault right now. Mm-hmm. It's the fault of no one who's working right now. It's the fault of people who were working 100 years ago and decided everything should be a commodity, as you mentioned.
Yeah.
And to do that, they simplified everything. So everyone was growing one wheat that was grown to be sturdy and long-lasting and non-greasy, so non-fatty, so it wouldn't go bad. So it became more of a simple carbohydrate than a complex carbohydrate. And one thing that we can talk about since we're talking about bread is people's gluten allergies. And I don't like it when people dismiss when people say they're gluten intolerant or something like that. I think that maybe those people are not gluten intolerant, but it's not their fault that they don't know that. Because of what you were talking about misinformation and how confusing it is, it might not be the gluten. It might be all the things that are added into commercially available bread.
Well, I think you're right. Like, again, there's no simple answer. And it's this knot that totally has to be untangled. And just a few things, like this is a common misperception of whole grain and another reason why people kind of look down on it because it's more expensive, as you pointed out, which again is more to do with the current system favoring the cheaper commodity.
Yes.
So a dollar is a powerful thing. You can put it towards the other way and you'd be surprised how much cheaper the wheat has already become in just a short amount of time.
Really?
Because again, it's like the more you invest in the miller, the more she can invest in the farmer and everything. And the farmers, you know, like people aren't farmers who aren't in love with the earth and aren't in love with what they're doing. And if you're in love with anything, there is a habituation, right? And so what keeps it exciting is to, for the farmers, plant new things, try experiments. But with the way that wheat is grown in this country, there's no incentive to do that because all the wheat gets pulled into the same place.
Right.
So one farmer pouring his soul into it and another farmer loading it up with pesticides or doing whatever, they're paid the same amount and it all gets mixed in. So after a while, like that's going to deaden your passion if it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And so I've found only, because it used to be this misconception that farmers didn't want to grow it. And it's like, that's not true. Every farmer we talk to is like, oh my God, yes, like please pick me. I'll plant it. And so as people invest in this, that's going to drop. Another thing you mentioned was the fact that in order to create longer storage, we kind of strip the grain of these things. And what we found recently, adding it back in and kind of testing these theories, is that grain with everything intact, wouldn't you imagine, lasts longer because it has everything. It's already lasted so long, and even crushed, it has everything intact to let it last longer.
Interesting.
So it doesn't necessarily, I don't know, a lot of things that I kind of was taught have been disproven. You know, a lot of this idea that you can't make X with whole grain. Turns out it just has to do with, like, getting in touch with a great miller who knows how to, like, break it down, you know? So these craftsmen that we're celebrating, we need to find these smaller chains that used to be there as well and kind of notch them all together.
Yeah.
But all of this is kind of a prejudice, I think, against whole grains that can't be done, that it's too expensive. And heritage, I think, is another kind of buzzword that we're talking about. And there are ancient grains, there are heritage grains, there are modern grains that are great. And it really isn't even like ancient grains is like anything older than 100 years.
I know. Our definitions are a little funky right now.
And our heritage grains are like older than 60 years, right? So these are all still pretty new. Mm-hmm. And yet I see people selling flour who are like, this is from a 3,000-year-old crop. And it's like, we don't really have those anymore. Just by evolution alone, like, except in the vault in Norway.
Right. Right, in the you seed know. Vault.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Which I recently read was under attack from rising sea levels.
Oh my gosh. We're ruined. We're ruined. So let's talk about baguettes. You know, like, what the fuck? Ay, ay, ay.
When in doubt, do as the French.
Yeah, exactly. They seem pretty relaxed. Well, they smoke a lot, but whatever. Maybe we should all start smoking. It'll relax us.
Do as the French.
Yeah. So I came across a term when I was researching that I wasn't familiar with. It's lean dough. Mm. And I realized that if you Google the phrase lean dough, the first results you get back are not accurate. They're like, it's low fat dough. I was like, no. I know that's not what I'm looking for here. Lean dough kind of just means simple, right?
Lean dough means there's no fat introduced. So a lean dough has flour, water, salt.
Right. Nothing added to it.
Well, I mean, if modern no day, extras. If there was yeast, mm-hmm. it would still count as a lean dough. The minute you add a fat, it becomes an enriched dough. So mm-hmm. adding milk, yogurt, butter, these things that create cinnamon buns, and brioche, and make me weak in the knees. These are enriched doughs as opposed to lean doughs. Yeah. So the baguette is a classic lean dough.
Yeah, because there's not much in it.
Yeah. Well,
relatively speaking,
there's all you need.
Yes. So tell us what goes into a baguette.
So for us, a baguette is, as I said, a whole grain flour, water, and sea salt. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Our starter is made up of flour and water, the same ones that we use for the doughs. So we are never adding in more than those three ingredients.
Do you have a mother for your baguettes?
I do.
Okay. So it's not...
I like to call her mama.
Mama. So you are using, like in this, people talk about mothers usually with sourdough because it's something associated with fermentation. But you've got baguettes always bubbling away like a little bit at a time. Mm-hmm, like, okay. Interesting. And then how do you cook baguettes yourself?
How do we bake them?
I mean, is there steam involved?
Whenever you're making bread, you want to have steam.
Okay.
Because the whole idea is keeping the area exposed to the oven malleable enough, moist enough to allow for the inside to expand before it sets. Oh. If you don't have steam, the top sets and that air needs to get out. And so it'll explode and you'll just have really wonky looking bread and really tight, uneven crumbs. So steam is this like wonderful lubricator to let the oven spring happen, which is, you know, that big puff that happens in the oven. Oh, the spring.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. So many terms. Good heavens. And then I read that the shininess that you get on the top of the crust of a baguette comes from the dextrose that's naturally occurring.
Yeah, so it's the sugars that are in the grains. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of bread in this country is baked really blonde, shall we say?
What does that mean?
It's really light, you know? Okay. I'm sure you've seen bread where you're like, has that been in an oven?
Oh, sure, sure.
You know, or it's just colored yellow.
Yeah.
And then you see bread coming out of Europe and it's sometimes black, you know, and this is another conversation we have with a lot of customers where it's like there's a difference between burnt and caramelization, right? And grains want to be caramelized because they have wonderful sugars in them, especially whole grains. They have all these fatty acids and sugars that really caramelize out and become incredibly shiny and crackly when they're properly fermented. And so for me, if it is not well-baked, or as the French say, bien cuit, then it's not done, you know? And I feel like when you pick up a blonde baguette, like it doesn't meet a lot of the check marks that a baguette needs to meet. And it feels doughy inside. And the kind of the beauty of a baguette is that really crusty outer and that just tiny amount of like pillowy inside.
Yeah. Okay. So some people think that the word was invented in the 1920s. That's not true. Baguettes became much more commonplace mm-hmm. in the 1920s because of various laws. France loves to have laws about food.
Yeah.
So France actually has like a wide-ranging bread tradition, all kinds of different breads and styles and ingredients. And one tell for that is that bakers are called boulangers, mm-hmm. and boule is the round French bread with it's a much heartier bread mm-hmm. than a baguette. So you know that, like, if they're called the round hearty bread makers, they're not called the baguetteers or something like that.
That's more of a Disney quality to right, it, doesn't it?
Right. But we do know that baguettes were around. There are some apocryphal stories. This story might be true, but it's often said that Napoleon invented the baguettes. He did not. What he did do, no. I'm getting so confused. I get so confused about made-up stories. There is a story that he wanted bread that the soldiers could put in their pants so they didn't have to carry it.
I haven't heard this one.
I mean, this is obviously ridiculous. My point being that we know that baguettes already existed because he was talking about, like, let's have them have baguettes, not boules, because yeah. they can just put them down their pants so they don't have to carry them.
He had a use for something that was already in place.
Exactly.
The legend I am familiar with that I think is generally accepted is that Louis XIV demanded that his bakers make a bread with more crust to crumb ratio because he himself liked the crusty outer part more.
Okay.
And so the bakers, under threat of their lives, because mm-hmm. that's always the threat with royalty.
Yes.
Invented the baguette to satisfy him. But it didn't really look like the modern day baguette. It was long and flat, so it met his requirements. Mm-hmm. And over the next couple hundred years, it sort of morphed into from wider to thinner and longer and longer and longer until in the 1890s, mm-hmm. there are like photos or drawings of people walking around with like 2 meters yes. long sticks, which can we bring that back? I mean, like,
I know.
I suppose I'm perfectly capable of bringing that back. But it
is
really,
your oven deep enough?
No, that's what I'm saying. Like, there's an access issue of yeah. like a size of an oven. But if you have a really deep oven, you would like yard long bread, call me.
Yeah, seriously, because you're absolutely right. You look at pictures like peasant street scenes mm-hmm. from 150 years ago, and there are people carrying baguettes that are just ludicrously
massive.
Long. Yeah.
But there's something really like wonderful and whimsical about it, right? Like in the mm-hmm. same way a cake has many layers and lots of frosting, like a comically large baguette adds a little magic to the world. And one of my favorite checklists for a baguette is that you be able to put it under your arm.
Yeah.
And drop your arm and it stays stiff.
Yeah.
Like if it limps, it's no good.
Right. Oh, no, we don't want a limpy baguette. No. That is a problem that happens in America and would mm-hmm. not happen at a reputable place no. in France. But you also, because you also want them to be able to stand up in your bicycle basket.
Yes, exactly.
Obviously.
And make everyone have FOMO that they don't yes. also have a baguette. I love this idea of like 2 meter long baguettes yeah. that had to still meet that quality.
Oh my God.
And just think about the wingspan if like your girlfriend was like, hey, Catherine, and you yeah. just like took out the crowd.
You have to like announce yourself that you're coming through for sure.
I'm turning left now.
Yeah, seriously. So the story about the king is interesting because, as you alluded to before, a lot of baguette's history, French bread's history, has to do with the French Revolution. Mm. And let them eat cake. You know, the advisor
lots
said
of food mm-hmm. and politics in mm-hmm. France.
And the story, which I'm. Who knows if it's true? Who cares? The advisor said they have no bread to eat, and she said, let them eat cake. And Louis having all kinds of... Louis XIV would have been her grandfather-in-law, right?
Yes.
Him, like,
I mean, I'm sure we're super sharp on a French royal family's lineage.
Well, it was Louis XVI. Who,
yeah.
So I'm assuming, I don't remember if there was a 15th. Maybe
or
he wasn't...
if there was another one in between. Sometimes they chose other names
I
and
know.
Skipped.
That's true. That's true. Well, some dickbag named Louis made a huge big issue about bread. What a jerk. So one of the problems was indeed that bread was somehow stratified, and I don't understand. People say that the poor people weren't allowed to eat white bread. I'm assuming that means it was priced so exorbitantly
yes.
that they just couldn't.
And also, the monarch basically had a control on that supply. So even if it, like, it could have been priced ridiculously one day and even more ridiculously than not the next, because it wasn't about your ability to purchase, this was not for you.
Right. Okay. I see. So after the French Revolution, one of the laws that they wrote was that we're only making one kind of bread now. Mm-hmm. And that was called pain d'égalité. Equality bread.
Yep. Love it.
Such a lovely concept. Apparently no one liked it. It was disgusting to them. Did not care for it. Like, no one. No one was grateful to finally have this bread.
Yeah.
It was just so abhorrent to them. One thing that I think is interesting about that is that a reason everyone in France found it so abhorrent is because it tended to contain a lot of bran. It had to be mixed grains. Mm-hmm. And one of them was bran. Now, in that particular time and place, bran was something that you would throw to the dogs, literally. It was mm-hmm. dog food. So I think there was a lot of that human revulsion going on. I wonder if that bread would be more accepted now that we're into, like, whole grains.
Well, I think probably, you know, if you go back further, before they could sift out bran, it would have been appreciated as just a taste because it just was. And I think the minute we had tools to, like, separate and kind of control the expression of these things, you had, you know, anyone who's had white bread forever, the first time they put whole wheat bread in their mouth is like, what is this? You know?
Yeah, yeah.
And this whole idea of equality bread, like, for me, it reads not only as, like, of course, why would white bread eaters suddenly like this bread, but also, you're right, it was like that was the only bread that could be made, and there was a rich history of whole grain, not whole grain breads, but more peasant style breads that were done for flavor. Mm-hmm. And this was a bread that was done
for politics,
yeah, by lawyers,
right?
And
right.
When I was a lawyer, I was not a great baker, so like that was not my main concern. So it is not a shock to me that they were not thinking of the flavor rule when they were sussing this out,
right? Right. Now, this law seems to have just sort of fizzled out because no one cared for the bread at all. Mm-hmm. It was a fixed price bread. Also, that was an important part of it. Mm-hmm. Finally, essentially. But it just seems like they never actually changed the law. It's just that bakers started going back to baking whatever they wanted, and that was fine.
Yeah, I think it got to the point, you know, in this Reconstruction period post-revolution where, like, there were bigger problems than, like, this kind of thing. And kind of on a different topic in terms of, like, the history of restaurants or what we think of as modern restaurants came about post-Revolutionary War in France as well, because now the monarchs didn't have all the chefs and these trained, skilled workers needed to work. So they opened what we now consider restaurants, but there were just little supper clubs, and they started baking as part of the dinners. And suddenly that kind of broke the bubble that released these recipes back into the world, and people just started baking whatever they wanted.
Oh,
yeah.
I like that.
I only recently started reading about, like, the history of the modern day restaurant, and mm-hmm. it's very fascinating. And it does kind of come from these, like, displaced aristocratic workers who, this is still what they love to do.
And we're talking specifically about high-end restaurants, because there were taverns and pubs and all that kind of stuff.
There were taverns and pubs like that, but this idea of you going and sitting down and there being a menu that you, like, picked from, as opposed to, like, a pub where there was, like, a plate of food.
You'll take
which
it.
Which I think has, yeah, you'll take it. And I think that kind of has some charm, too.
Right,
it's like,
right.
It's $7 and this is what I'm serving tonight. You don't want it, you can go.
Yeah.
But it's good.
Yeah.
You know, and that was kind of the basis of taverns and pubs. And these restaurants came about from these more highly skilled workers who would start opening these little, like, supper clubs. And then people started leaving their homes to eat, and that itself was kind of revolutionary,
right?
To, and, like, that, have a whole meal,
and that also coincided with the advent of electricity.
Yes.
Didn't coincide; it was enabled by electricity.
Because you could eat later into the mm-hmm. night, and you could dine longer.
Yep.
So there was a lot of, like,
and be out and about.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
a lot of intertwined.
Yes. Can you imagine being alive at, like, the time when nightlife was really becoming
a new thing?
Yeah, people going from, like, well, it's dark out, night, to being like, oh my gosh, we are going to go to a club. I think that would be so exciting. I wonder if they were aware of this change. I think they must have been, because I'm very aware of the ways that, like, when I was in high school, our junior year, I think, we were all taken to the University of Washington Library and taught how to research. And I wonder if my high school still has that segment of English class. Or if they have like a best Google practices.
They take you to the library and they're like, this is a computer. This is how you, if you don't know this, it's really sad because you've been born into this world.
Exactly. Yeah.
Which doesn't replace real research.
I mean, I think there's a difference if for no other reason than not every book has been uploaded to the internet.
Yet. Yes. Yes.
And that seems like enough reason to like know how to read books still and find books and by code.
Well,
and also kind of
with
stuff.
More resources, you still need to be analytical and kind of picky about it. So like include books in your search.
This is the whole thing about a liberal arts education is that it teaches you how to think.
Yes. Yeah.
It's not just about knowing who all the authors are. It's about knowing how to use your noggin.
See, and I think about nightlife, and I think it was probably a little more drastic than what you've described from like, oh, it's dark, I'll go to bed. I think it was more like, it's dark, there are witches out, to let's go clubbing.
You gotta watch out for witches.
I mean, there are still witches out.
Yeah, but haven't they chilled out a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, you know, they're more, it's more like chanting and love potions.
When I think of contemporary witches, I feel like, one, they're kind of minding their own business, and two, they're sort of... aren't they all in Topanga? They're just like hanging out. They're having a good time on their
own
terms. Yeah. Yeah, I don't think of witches as scary anymore. No. Old school witches. Well, their foremothers
were. I think that's
because
we have lights at night.
You're totally right. You're totally right. That makes a lot of sense. So the whole thing about baguettes, some people thinking they were invented in 1920, was that another food law was written into being in France, and it was that bakers couldn't work between the hours of 10 p.m. and 4 a.m.
I gotta say, I'm kind of for this law.
I can see why you would be.
I think it's a very, like, worker-friendly, life stability kind of, what is it they say, treating yourself approach to baking.
Or just work-life balance. I mean, I remember, speaking of things changing, I remember growing up, there was always this sense that in America we worked the hardest and we were the best for it, and countries like France were a bunch of dirty hippies who never got anything done because they got vacation time, for instance. Now I'm very much in a place where I'm like, there's no reason to dedicate your life to your job.
Isn't it also crazy that someone somehow managed so simply to make you hate vacation? To make you think it was a bad thing.
Right.
And you're like, wait a second.
Isn't that the greatest trick that the man has ever played?
Oh, there's so many of them, I think. And you're right. Like, you look at other countries, they work half as much. Maybe they're not, like, number one economic power, but they're number two, three, and four.
Yeah, and honestly, given their size, I mean, per capita, are Germany and France that much behind us? They might even be ahead of us.
No, it's almost more impressive.
Yeah.
And considering then they also top the other list for one, two, and three.
Like happiness.
Like happiness.
Yeah.
Longevity. Education, healthcare. It's, you know, I think we should really consider this like a point system, maybe.
Interesting.
Because unfortunately, if we did, I'm sure we'd be like, well, it's golf. And we win because we have the lowest, you know?
Yeah. Oh, my God. You're right. People would twist it around. But I think I love these worker-friendly laws. I love that everyone in France gets Friday afternoon off. Why? It doesn't change your business at all.
No. And it really does wonders for morale and people feeling like one. And I don't even know that it's work, because we have plenty of people who, like, that's all they want to do. But like you said, it's life balance. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're doing only one thing, I think that there's just inherent human fatigue.
Yes.
And for most of us in this country, it is work.
Yeah.
So, I would like to have more vacation, please.
More vacation seems great. Although if they all of a sudden were like, fine, take time off now, I'd be like, I can't afford it. So they've really gotten us in a pickle.
Well, a lot of that vacation though is paid leave.
I know.
So a lot of structural changes.
I know.
Necessary.
So much has to go on, and we're moving away from all of that.
I was going to say, only getting more complicated.
Boom, boom, boom. Anyway, the whole no baking between the hours of 10 p.m. and 4 a.m. meant that more bakeries started making more baguettes because they're quicker to cook.
Yep. And you know, a lot of bakeries now are embracing that. You know, Tartine up in San Francisco, their big round bowls don't come out until the afternoon. for a very similar reason. You know, they don't want to have their employees. They're like ridiculously into the night and kind of burn them out because, you know, you have a circadian rhythm. You can only do that for so long.
Yeah.
No matter how much you love what you do. We used to also have bread come out in the afternoon and we'd do smaller breads in the morning because it made a lot of sense to keep a work-life balance and still get people bread.
Yeah.
And you most of the time in the morning, you're eating smaller things. So again, it makes sense with the rhythms of those things. And okay. I think a lot of this again is we've forgotten our history.
Mm-hmm.
And the many things that people in our history discovered, the wonderful lessons. You know, I like to say, you know, we're never this was said to me and I strongly adhere to it, that we're never really inventing something new. Everything old is new again. Mm-hmm. And you're just standing on the shoulders of giants and trying to push it forward a little, you know. And it's important that we remember that because otherwise you are trying to reinvent the wheel constantly. You're giving yourself so much more work and agitation than you need.
Yeah, yeah. Oh my gosh, that's so interesting. Also, people need to remember to think outside themselves. I've worked at two different locations of a franchise called Great Harvest, which is based in Montana, and they make hippie bread.
Mm-hmm.
And people would come in at 10 and look at the board of the breads that were coming out and see that a bread wasn't coming out till noon, and they would lose their fucking minds. And I was like, I would always think there's no possible way that you are at this level of rage constantly.
At 10 in the morning.
Yeah. Have you, like, are you, is this what you've decided to spew all your frustrations about? Is what else is going on in your life that you've decided to freak out in public about a loaf of bread? Do you know what I mean?
Oh, we used to have people freak out on us all the time. I've received some of the most poor economics lessons from impatient customers.
Really?
Or we've sold out of something and someone decides to explain to me the way supply and demand works.
Oh, that must be neat. Is
no
it always
understanding.
A man? Oh my God.
And they're like, well, I have a demand, so where's your supply? I'm like, that's not quite how this works.
Yeah. Oh, how interesting.
But they're so confident and they're so displeased. And, you know, I think that, I mean, I don't even really blame them because we have this saying in this country that isn't popular in other countries that the customer is always right.
Yeah.
And I think that has risen to a level of psychosis where it becomes the customer is always entitled. The customer is always blank check forgiven for being cruel.
Yeah.
The customer can easily forget that I'm another human being.
Yeah.
And it just gives them this blank check basically to do whatever they want and feel like you have to accommodate them. And I constantly feel caught in this situation where I'm like, I'm not sure I would put up with this if I was your mother.
Right.
So why are you asking me to mother you constantly? And again, like I want to say, like, I'm profoundly grateful people are so excited about our products. And I'm sure when you were working there, you were grateful that people were excited about your products. But, you know, take a breath.
I know. It's almost like be excited without having the flip side, which is the rage. And maybe that's just asking too much.
You just go right over it.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, man. But hopefully most of your customers are kind people who are just...
Most of our customers are kind people. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And you know what? Like, I don't feel like anyone's immune. Like, even if you are a kind, good soul, I'm sure there's a moment when because of your day or your expectations or how far you've traveled, someone is out of something and like... It just comes out of you.
All you wanted that day was a rye brownie.
Yeah. Yeah. I think what's important, what keeps you a good person is if you like can at some point like course correct and be like, wow, I am a handful.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah. And a good way to do that is to get a baguette, sit down with some butter.
Yeah.
And be European about it. Don't worry about it. Slather that butter on.
Yeah. Rarely at a bakery is there not something also delicious you can get if they're out of your favorite thing.
Yeah. Try something new.
Mm-hmm.
Try a new carb. They're all delicious.
Go crazy.
Yeah, exactly. You never know what you're going to find. Rose, thank you so much for joining us today. Where can people find you and your products?
So you can find us online at eatredbread.com.
Mm-hmm.
We are also on Instagram as @redbread, and we post a lot of our upcoming classes, new products that we're introducing, and other really fun stuff. And we always love to interact with home bakers, bread enthusiasts, and so it'd be really great to hear from you. And I've had so much fun.
Yay, me too. Thank you so much for coming on to Smart Mouth.
Thank you for having me, Catherine.
les orgues, elle joue pour toi. Il est terrible, cette terre-là. J'espère que tu aimes, c'est assez beau, non? C'est le requiem pour un con. Ouais, je l'ai composé spécialement pour toi, à ta mémoire de...